We the people of the United States.
In order to form a more perfect union.
This is a very dangerous time.
Establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility.
Provide for the common defense.
Promote the general welfare.
The agenda of the radical right is incredibly extreme.
And secure the blessings of liberty.
Since September 11th, the Constitution has been stood on its head.
To ourselves and our posterity.
It really speaks to what we believe America is all about, and this affects everyone.
To ordain and establish
this Constitution
for the United States of America. The framers, they'd seen a country ruled by tyrants. They insisted on one ruled by laws. They were right. Over two centuries, our Constitution, laws, and courts have preserved freedom, equality, justice, not just for the powerful, but those with no power. Infallible? No. Indispensable? Absolutely. But over the past 25 years, an increasingly influential movement of ultra-conservatives has waged a quiet war on this vision of the law.
They believe that the government ought to have vast power to invade our lives and little or no power to protect us, particularly the most vulnerable among us.
By overturning decades of precedent, ultra-conservatives aim to dismantle vital laws,
is a cultural war,
wage a culture war,
as critical to the kind of nation we shall be as the Cold War itself.
Expand presidential power.
Do I have the legal authority to do this? And the answer is absolutely.
An unpopular agenda hidden beneath a torrent of political rhetoric.
Activist judges, activist federal judges.
An activist judge.
This is the one phrase, judicial activism, that gets everybody on their hind legs.
I don't believe in liberal activist judges. I believe in strict constructionists.
The out-of-control judiciary, and this was in your last book, Courting Disaster,
yeah,
is the most serious threat America has faced in nearly 400 years of history. More serious than Al-Qaeda, more serious than Nazi Germany and Japan, more serious than the Civil War?
George, I really believe that. I think they are destroying the fabric that holds our nation together.
What they have said is that our judges will just follow the law, and that they are strict constructionists who won't legislate from the bench. Exclamation point.
Would strictly interpret and apply the law.
They're not going to legislate from the bench.
Should interpret the law and not make it up.
And the strict interpretation of the law.
And that has been phenomenally effective. It's a lie. It's not the case that they're just following the law.
Judicial conservatives have gotten the idea that maybe a little bit of judicial activism, or a lot of judicial activism, is really okay as long as it's judicial activism for the causes they believe in.
What seems to typify their view is activism when it helps their cause, and restraint when it helps their cause.
They call themselves conservative. Their goals are not.
What would happen if Clarence Thomas and Antonin Scalia got their way? What is their sort of vision for America? And if you say to people what their vision is, you know, say goodbye to workers' rights, say goodbye to environmental protection, say goodbye to women's rights, say goodbye to the rights of the disabled, you know, say goodbye to all the progress that we've made in terms of race and gender in this country and privacy.
This would be a program of constitutional revision, which is pretty much unprecedented in our nation's history. If they succeed, we will, without really seeing it happen, end up with a very different country, one that's both less free and less equal.
How did all this start? Many date it to 1964. Barry Goldwater, a Republican candidate from the extreme right.
I will remind you that extremism in the defense of liberty is no vice.
Goldwater lost in a landslide, but his defeat galvanized ultra-conservatives. They didn't get that far with their agenda, though, until 1980.
I, Ronald Reagan, do solemnly swear.
I, Ronald Reagan, do solemnly swear.
They moved aggressively under Reagan, led by people like Attorney General Edwin Meese and young lawyers like Samuel Alito. If there was ever any doubt about what they planned, that disappeared in 2002 when law professor Don Johnson exposed documents that made it crystal clear.
The Reagan-Meese memos were issued by the Department of Justice in the 1980s to set forth a blueprint for radically moving constitutional law to the right by overruling a series of landmark Supreme Court decisions on all the great issues of the day.
Meese didn't act alone. Ultra-conservatives had partners on the outside, big business and big money. They poured millions into law schools, into think tanks, into nonprofit law firms, and into a group called the Federalist Society. It began as a forum for debate. It turned into a way to groom lawyers for high government office and the federal bench. And there were more allies, allies on the religious right. They said to change the law, you had to change the courts.
Amen.
And what you saw beginning in the early 1980s was really a coming together of conservative ideas, conservative intellectuals, conservative lawyers, and conservative money, all pointing in one direction. And the direction was, let's get the people we want on the courts.
1987, an opening on the Supreme Court. Ultra-conservatives thought they had their man. Judge Robert Bork scorned the right to privacy, called constitutional precedent not all that important, and even opposed the principle of one man, one vote.
I think, Senator, I not only wrote that, I still think I was right.
Americans rejected Judge Bork's ideas, and the Senate rejected his nomination.
Leniency in the courtroom and the fashioning of new rules to protect criminals.
After Bork's defeat, ultra-conservatives pushed their agenda behind a barrage of buzzwords.
Who support judicial restraint.
Put people on the bench who are strict constructionists.
Judicial restraint.
Interpreting the law, not writing it.
Will interpret the laws.
Won't legislate from the bench. More strict constructionists.
Interpret the law and not try to
legislate from the bench.
They also learned how to package their nominees.
Now I think they pretty much have a script.
Would be best that I not comment.
It would be improper for me to express a view.
And I don't want to comment on the correctness or incorrectness.
I have no quarrel, Senator.
I don't have any quarrel with that conclusion.
And I have no quarrel with it.
Have an open mind.
Every case with an open mind.
I would approach the question with an open mind.
There is significant weight to be given to existing case law.
It certainly is a precedent of the court.
My job is to take those precedents seriously.
Say as little as possible. Speak in generalities when you can, and when you ask for specifics, try to dodge.
We no longer have candid, revolutionary efforts to change the American Constitution as we know it. We rather have a stealth revolution.
I believe the Constitution protects the right to privacy.
You're not suggesting that there wasn't any discussion at any time of Roe versus Wade?
I cannot. Senator, I cannot remember personally engaging in those discussions.
Justice Thomas, when asked about Roe against Wade, said he had never talked about it to anyone. And then, of course, when he gets on the bench, he makes his position absolutely plain from the get-go.
I don't have any objection or basis to object or at this point any quarrel with the way that the court has interpreted the interstate commerce clause.
Ultra-conservatives perfected the spin and put judges on the bench. They also went to work. Item one, distort key sections of the Constitution, like the Commerce Clause, to erode our most vital laws, laws rooted in FDR's New Deal and its legacy.
The New Deal vision has made America what it is today, a country where the government has certain responsibilities for its people. It checks our water, it checks our food, it protects us, we hope, when there's a hurricane.
That is one of the most scary areas in which they are trying to radically change the law. Congress will be robbed of its power to enact federal legislation that it believes is necessary to protect the American people.
I grew up in the South, so I've personally experienced segregation, separate water fountains, separate bathrooms, separate schools, being bused across town because of my race. It's a constant reminder that when the chips are down, Congress, with its failings to be sure, has come to the fore and done things that really make a difference in people's lives.
Despite their complaints about judicial activism, the quiet revolutionaries cheered when the Rehnquist Court started chipping away at the New Deal legacy in the 1990s.
There is no question that the Rehnquist Court not only was an activist court, but in many ways the most activist court we've ever seen.
The Rehnquist Court struck down more than 35 federal laws, laws affecting workers, seniors, people with disabilities, school children, women, and religious minorities. Some justices and lower court judges have even tried to go further, trying to strike down laws that protect us from pollution, provide family and medical leave, ban machine guns, protect our privacy, and ensure a living wage.
Part of the conservative agenda seems to be to entirely dismantle consumer protections, basic market regulations that have endured and created one of the most prosperous societies in history, the most prosperous society in history.
Stand up, speak up, and refuse to give up.
They are self-described Christocrats, evangelical Christians who have every intention of mixing church and state in order to stack the federal bench in their favor.
They still don't have as many judges as would be needed to overturn Roe. They need one more.
Ultra-conservatives win the most media attention for their campaigns abortion. Against abortion and gay rights, but their goals are far more ambitious. They say the law gives government little power to make America more fair, but great power to tell people how to live their lives.
The distinctive feature of the position of Justice Scalia and Thomas is not that they're merely against abortion. They are against the very idea of the right to privacy. They would overrule Griswold against Connecticut.
Yeah, if you'd been a Supreme Court judge and Griswold versus Connecticut, the famous birth control case came up, which centered around whether there's a right to privacy.
Right.
Do you believe that was correctly decided?
No, I don't. I write about it in the book.
The state of Connecticut had the right to ban birth control.
I think they were wrong.
Couples.
It was a bad law.
But they had the right.
They had the right. They had the right.
And it would therefore be legitimate for the state of Connecticut to say we want to ban contraceptives. There's no question about that.
The privacy right has, I mean, it's sort of this invented right.
So in their view, the right to privacy, which includes the right to keep your medical and business records private, which includes the right to live with members of your family, which includes the right not to be sterilized. On one view, that is the radical view, the right to privacy doesn't exist. It's a constitutional fabrication, and it should be eliminated entirely.
There's something else they say doesn't exist. The constitutional wall separating church and state. Those words come from Thomas Jefferson's famous letter explaining the First Amendment's Establishment Clause, a clause that carries no weight for some.
Well, first of all, I don't believe in the separation of church and state.
Justice Thomas has actually said the separation of church and state doesn't apply to the states.
Now, what this means is that the states, any state, could, if it wanted to, declare an official state-supported religion and use tax money officially, over the table, no, without embarrassment, to support that religion, to pay the salaries of clergymen from that religion. The state could do that if it wanted to. There'd be no constitutional objection. I think that would be a real serious break with the way we've done things in American life for a long time now.
I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow.
After the Watergate scandal, Americans learned that the executive branch had spied on peace groups, on political opponents, even on Martin Luther King. And they learned that the president had considered himself above the law.
Well, when the president does it, that means that it is not illegal.
After Nixon's downfall, Congress passed laws to restore checks and balances. To ultra-conservatives like Dick Cheney, this was all wrong. They wanted the president to have even more power. They thought they could do that in the Reagan years.
I do.
The Reagan-Meese agenda was to dramatically limit the powers of Congress and the courts and expand the power of the presidency. That's the simplest way to put it.
They made some headway then. But 13 years later came September 11th. That gave them another chance.
This administration has come to power in the thrall of a legal theory that aims to convince us that this excessive concentration of presidential power is exactly what our Constitution intended.
This expansive view even alarms some of the president's supporters.
I think the administration has looked at legitimate power of the executive during a time of war and taken it to extremes, to the point that we would lose constitutional balance. And it concerns me that it could basically neuter the Congress and weaken the courts. That's where we're at right now.
I don't believe that's where we're at right now, sir.
That's where you're at with me.
The Bush administration has brushed aside the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act and the Constitution to spy on Americans.
It is against the law to wiretap or eavesdrop on the conversations of Americans in this country without a warrant from a judge. But the New York Times says that is exactly what the president secretly ordered the National Security Agency to do in the months after 9/11.
Do I have the legal authority to do this? And the answer is absolutely.
The law is that you go to the court and you get a warrant. The law was enacted with speed in mind. It said you can go out and do whatever it is you have to do without wasting 1 second, and then come back retroactively to do the paperwork, to get the warrant.
And the president, rather than seeking to change that, rather than going to Congress and saying, I need broader authority, simply violated a criminal statute and went out and secretly, without congressional approval and without any judicial approval, went out and violated the law.
To hardliners, the president's authority to get around wiretap laws knows no bounds.
So you can't rule out purely domestic warrantless surveillance between two Americans?
I'm not going to rule it out, but what I've outlined for you is the framework in which we would analyze that question.
What other powers would they grant the president?
Basically, the power to lock up human beings without trial, without lawyers, on the president's say-so, without any meaningful judicial review.
That allows them to arrest an American citizen on American soil and put them in prison, keep them there indefinitely, and they never see a lawyer or a judge, never get a hearing, never get a chance to prove that they did nothing wrong. I mean, these kind of policies go to the heart of what America is about.
They've even said the president can authorize torture.
They've claimed this right to engage in torture, even though American law makes torture a crime. Less than 2 weeks ago, the White House claimed the right to set aside the McCain torture amendment that passed the Senate 90-9.
The president's argument echoes the infamous torture memo written by former Justice Department official Jay Bybee.
The Office of Legal Counsel at the Justice Department, they issued a legal opinion, which they kept very secret, in which it concluded that the President of the United States had the power to override domestic and international laws outlawing torture.
Lawyers in that office actually advised the Attorney General of the United States, it's only torture if your organs are failing.
What the Bybee memo led to didn't stay a secret.
Abu Ghraib is a national disgrace. It's a stain on our Constitution, and it's a stain on our reputation in international law. What essentially has been said is that the president's power as commander-in-chief allows him to function as a torturer-in-chief, and that's certainly nothing that was part of any original constitutional vision.
The law may be hard and complicated, but the law isn't any one person gets to say what the law is. That's the original understanding of the U.S. Constitution.
In the past 2 years, ultra-conservatives saw the Supreme Court repudiate their view of presidential power. But the justices they idolize embraced it. And Jay Bybee has a lifetime judgeship on the Ninth Circuit. So can we stop the quiet revolution? Is it too late?
It's not too late at all. I think we've done a good job of pushing back, but we have to keep doing it. We have to push back harder. what we have to keep in mind is that we're on the right side, and we've always been on the right side. We're protecting people who need our protection, but we've got to make certain that we're doing it in a way that is really competitive. So we've got to be smarter and harder working and more aggressive in presenting the arguments that we think are the right arguments.
I think my hope for my generation is that we'll dream big. This is what the right did about 30 years ago, and they've been incredibly successful. I think we need to be incredibly ambitious about the fact that people genuinely care about the same things that we genuinely care about, and about communicating that passion to everybody and making this an inclusive movement that everybody in America is committed to.
What's remarkable about history is ordinary people doing extraordinary things. Last year, Rosa Parks passed away. I remember sitting on this stage with world leaders and Bill Clinton and senators and governors and thinking we were all paying homage to a seamstress who had transformed the country and helped transform the world. We never know sort of how our actions are going to ripple. We may surprise ourselves with the amount of influence that in fact we have just by standing up or speaking up.
So when this film is over, don't just go home. Go to work, because there's plenty of work to do, whether you're a lawyer taking a case, a philanthropist writing a check, a politician creating a law, or a student leading an organization. Victory, Teddy Roosevelt said, comes to those in the arena. Enter it. We won't succeed in one day. It'll take every day and every one of us, but we can do it. Freedom, equality, justice. We must fight to protect that vision of the law so that our laws can protect us.